everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we are doing our September garden tour part two. Now, after looking at our garden part one and then looking at what we did for part two, we didn't like part two. So one of the reasons we wanted to do it over again is because of this very bush right here. Now, this is an Alberta spruce, a dwarf Alberta spruce. And when we did part one, it looked just like this, and its two buddies. When we looked at what we had done for part two the first time, this one was totally dead. And it was a matter of weeks. Suddenly, it was dead. And when we dug that one up to take in and get a new one, because of it was under warranty, we realized that there was no soil underneath. Remember back in a couple of videos before, we had a sinkhole behind me, and it was because there used to be giant maples here.
That's the one you fell in, right?
And that's the one I fell in, and I thought I was going to get swallowed. Well, it must have been another root that was over here, and when we planted it the first time, it seemed perfectly fine, and it did fine for probably 2 months. And then suddenly, within 2 weeks, it was done. So when we put this new one in, we made sure that there was soil packed around and that there was not just an empty hole. And we'll be watching it closely. If it looks like it's not happy, we'll do something else.
We'll move it.
Again. Looking at this iris patch, you know iris like to have attention given to them. So I will be cutting all of these down to about this height. And that way, and cleaning out any debris that might be in their old leaves from these trees, anything that's in their weeds, so that they have a nice clean area to grow in. And because I'm leaving them up this high, it will catch the snow. Hopefully we'll have some. And that will be like a blanket to insulate them. So they'll be much happier in the spring. When we come out our kitchen door, we are just so pleased to see so many things that are still blossoming. And it's almost getting to the end of September. So when you have plants that still blossom, we are very lucky. So we have a mammoth mum, we have marigolds, we have these are snapdragons that have seeded themselves many times. Of course, that's sweet alyssum.
Yeah, amazing, all the pollinators that are still really, really happy at this point.
They're very happy that there are flowers, as are the hummingbirds, which are still around.
Yeah, I was seeing them yesterday.
Yes. But if you turn over to this side, look at all of these snapdragons. I haven't planted snapdragons for years, but if you just leave them there, they will go to seed and they will come up again in the spring. It's one of our dear viewers told us that this is a star.
I think it was a yellow star.
Yellow star dahlia, which we've never seen before.
This one is on its tail end,
yes,
because like
is.
I said, we filmed this maybe what, a week and a half ago or so?
But there are more coming, so as long as it doesn't freeze, dahlias will continue on. Once it does freeze, then we have to dig them up and put them in the basement.
I mean, I'm just looking here, and it's like flowers after flowers after flowers after flowers.
Yeah.
And
even the Mexican sunflower.
Yeah.
It still goes on, and the bees really like the Mexican sunflower.
Yeah, I know we talked about that in video number one. How about in the front? I don't know.
I think we saw these, but another look at... these are dahlias. These were the little tiny dahlias you bought.
The miniature, yeah.
Yeah. Right. I mean, some of them are really beautiful. So I guess I'm going to be...
Look at all the blossom heads mm-hmm. on there waiting to
yes.
pop open yet.
Yep.
I hope we have enough. And nasturtiums are going to
nasturtiums,
town.
Nasturtiums, coxcomb.
Yeah, we talked about that in video one.
Look at how weird these guys are.
Yeah.
Look at how beautiful this one is getting.
Well, that's getting much bigger than since we filmed in number one.
Yes. Well, and then there's the huge one behind you.
Right. That just, is that getting bigger?
This is just amazing. Just absolutely amazing, and I'm still waiting to see where the seeds would form. I haven't been able to figure that out yet. But each one of them is so different than the other. But these are zinnias.
I mean, these are like 2 foot taller than I am. You're looking at 8 foot Mexican sunflowers here.
And I keep cutting these old ones off because the pollinators are done with them. And if you cut the old ones off, new ones will continue on until they freeze. But here we go.
A honeybee.
And that's a honeybee. Yep. Yeah.
Just
so nice
full
to see.
Of pollinators.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know there's the big controversy about the mosquito squad, and I know they're spraying across the street from
them,
us.
Not only them, but all of them.
But
everybody.
You hate to see the spray. Now, they say they don't kill the bees, but
we have evidence that they do.
Yeah, and that's sad. We need these honeybees.
We need all of our pollinators or we're going to be really hungry.
Yep. But I like how you just randomly planted
dahlias
all over the place.
Dahlia here, a dahlia there.
Are you going to remember that they're here so you can dig them up?
Yeah, well, I have a name tag on that one.
You want to talk about tender bulbs?
Well, with tender bulbs, of course, you have to dig them up after the first frost. So you won't have any flowers on it then. They'll look pretty sad. But you just gently take a pitchfork and pull up what's underground. And then you're going to have to cut off the stem. But you don't want to cut it all the way down to the bottom. You want to let some of that energy that's still in the stem go down to the root part.
Well, I'm sure you're going to be doing a video again on how
sure
you prepare and care for.
But then
for
you have to take care of them all winter. So if you like tender bulbs, they'll be with you all year.
I mean, you've got another little snapdragon trying to find its home right there.
Yep.
And now this mom was one of the few mums.
Well, now I'm wondering if this wasn't one of the mammoth mums that I planted out here from what we had left over.
I think you're going to have to move it back farther because it's starting to encroach.
Because it's mammoth.
Yes.
And I think there's another one over there. The yellow one over there, I think, is also mammoth mum.
I think we talked about the reblooming wigelia.
Mm-hmm. Now, why it keeps reblooming, I don't know, but I'm happy it is. And then, of course, you've got those are...
Is that phlox?
Phlox that are, you know, they're at the end. Look at the cannas. The cannas are forming their own wall.
Mm.
Our older son planted his from the one little clump that we gave him a year ago. He divided them up. I said he could divide them. He kept them all winter and did a really good job. He now has 9 of them. And when you look at his side yard, it's like a forest of cannas that are not at least 9 feet tall.
Yeah, his are much taller than ours.
They're
but
amazing.
Then it's against a fence, which is a heat sink, so he can get them in a little bit earlier and keep them there a little bit later.
Yep. Yes. So there's another dahlia.
Yeah.
And the end of more phlox.
Well, the phlox, and then again more dahlias, and again another. Is that a wasp?
I don't know. All we know is it's a pollinator and it's happy.
Yes.
And then some of the hostas are still blooming. So different hostas bloom at different times.
Oh, also we'll have to talk about...
Some of them are fragrant and they are very, very delicious fragrances. We got one yesterday and we already had 2. So now we have 3. Some of you may remember that when we put those 3 little Alberta spruce in, we had to move some of the iris to get there. And instead of putting the iris all in one clump again, we decided we would spread them around and put like 3 or 4 in a clump or a group. And when they went in, they looked pretty bad.
They did. I didn't even think they were going to survive.
We kept stepping on them. I mean, we were really not nice to them. But they're doing well.
Is that another mammoth mum?
This is another mammoth mum, yes. This is a yellow daisy-like one. They come in a variety of colors. They are expensive, but they do come back every year.
More hostile blooming.
Yep, but these, of course, are some of our tree peonies that we raised from seed. These are obviously hostas, which I have not yet chopped off the seeds.
Deadhead.
Right, deadhead. That is a tree that needs to come out of there.
And how about your autumn joy sedum?
Yep, that's the sedum.
And even behind that, you see more phlox.
Yes, the phlox
and
do move.
Is that phlox way?
Yeah, it's on the other side of
the
fence. Yes. Yeah. So.
And here as well.
This is the area that we had done so much digging and getting rid of.
Oh, grass
of
in
grass.
Here. I mean,
so
it was almost waist high.
Yes.
It
so
was horrible.
Never ending, but you know, you can keep it under control to some point.
Well, I started covering it with cardboard
just
to keep the growth down. And once I get to the level that I'm happy with, I may have little pieces of cardboard underneath, but then I'm going to use that weed barrier. And once we have that in place, then it's going to be mulched. And that way, if you want to do any planting, it's just a matter of digging a hole, removing that area of the weed barrier, and planting to your heart's delight.
We will see how that goes. And we're still happy to say that some of the giant hibiscus are also still blooming. This one came out yesterday.
Now this is Jazzberry Jam.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this one will come out tomorrow. And this one will come out.
I mean, I don't remember seeing our hibiscus blossoming this late
in
the year.
It's been a strange year. Our white ones are also still blossoming, but not these over here, but the ones we planted.
The one in the front.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. So it's
well, that one I think
fun.
We showed in the very first video. Now, the white ones we notice are the only ones that have the viable seeds.
Sometimes.
Sometimes.
Not always. But see, this is a seed pod right here. This is how it looks when it's open.
Take that one off once if you can. You don't have
oh,
your little
sure.
cutter with you.
Okay, so if you open it up, you can see those little brown seeds in there. Now, sometimes they will fall on the ground and actually show up as a new plant in the spring. Most of the time, no.
Well, that's because the little critters eat them.
Well, that. And even though something is grown and the label might say it's sterile, they're not always 100% sterile. You may still have a plant
cross-pollinated by something else.
Well, not only that, but you know, sometimes they are fertile,
yeah.
Even though they say they aren't. Not 100%.
Well, I think we saw the last of the Midnight Marvel.
Yes.
But you still have, what this is this Speedwell?
We call this Smartweed.
Your Smartweed?
Right. Which is doing very happily.
And the pollinators like it.
Yes. And this is the one that usually gets eaten by the Japanese beetles. But since we only had a few Japanese beetles here, it didn't seem to bother them at all.
And look what...
Yes, and here is a compass plant.
Now, how did that get there?
Because it was over there. And it has flowers. And if it has flowers and the seeds are viable and they blow over...
They're all over the north driveway.
Those and the prairie dock.
Yes.
Prairie dock is even more so.
Oh.
Another plant that I don't plant every year, but I planted one time and I just let it go to seed, is asters. And while some people have trouble with deer eating their asters, this one doesn't seem to have that problem. And they just pop up wherever they want. Then look at that beautiful iris. Again, it's kind of nice to have them separated.
Yeah.
Here's a nice bumble enjoying the aster.
Mm-hmm. Well, they have to survive, and I know your compact Luna swirl, pink swirl, that too is about to hopefully be the last blossom. No, there will be more.
There you go. Huh. Some of them will just go until it freezes.
Yeah.
And the Stelladora lilies, they blossom when they want.
Yep. And I noticed that even on the back there, you've got that, what was that one?
That's the Cranberry Crush?
Yes.
Yes. One of my favorites.
Yeah, it is a beautiful, beautiful blossom. That one was open yesterday.
Oh, dear. And look up.
Uh-oh.
Now, yesterday I was out here pulling more and more morning glories
There
out,
they are.
And I missed that one. It starts down there.
Somewhere.
No, right there. I can see the flower.
Oh, yeah. I do, too.
And it's gone out. It was mixed in with this hibiscus and those hibiscus.
It literally took over this area.
It tried to get here. I mean, I pulled it out yesterday from those particular places.
Huh.
I also pulled some out of here. And I pulled some out from where we have all that mulch.
I saw.
See it? There's another one.
Yeah, there's another one.
So if you don't get the seeds, if you don't get the flower with the seeds, you're going to have more.
Mm.
The way it is. Then there's always these orange flowers that Richard likes really well. This is the in the black-eyed Susan family, Rebecca. Some people call them tickweed, tick flowers.
I like them.
He loves them. And the pollinators love them, and they seed themselves, and they move everywhere. They are happy.
Yeah. And your nursery for Montauk daisies, again, are doing really well.
Still have some peppers growing.
And you have mums that are blossoming back
those
here.
Those are, no, those are your dahlias. Again.
Oh, those are more of the dahlias. Yeah.
Those are beautiful red.
You've had a lot of cucumbers this year. Unfortunately, many of them you let get way too big.
They got out of control. You don't see them until they're big.
I know.
A lot of peppers.
Yeah.
Not so many large tomatoes.
No, well, they're finally starting, but even there, we've got a couple of picking now. You said you did, I think, three batches so far of canning tomatoes?
I canned probably a dozen, maybe two dozen. Bottles, quarts of tomatoes. Usually I do more than that, and usually I'd be done with the big ones by now.
Well, I still want you to make some more salsa. I miss my salsa.
Well, we should do that today. Now, again, here are some more of those dahlias. These are your dahlias.
Those are the little babies, huh?
Those are the tiny ones.
And is that another mammoth mom? Or?
No, that's more dahlias.
Oh, more dahlias. How many dahlias do you have
now? You bought a whole tray full, remember? They were tiny. They were in those tiny things.
Yeah.
And they sat because I was too busy and I couldn't plant them. And I pulled them. I had to really pull them out of their little containers because they were so
intertwangled
in there.
Intertwangled.
They were intertwangled. And so I planted them not knowing how they would do. Look at the pollinators on those orange ones.
Yeah.
There we go.
I mean, they're all over, and I'm so thankful that they are. But now there is a honeybee, thank goodness. Or is that a wasp? I'm trying to... I don't know about that one.
Well, and then
how about your...
That's a fig tree.
Fig tree.
That's our fig tree, and look how abundant it is.
This is the healthiest it's ever looked.
Yeah, it's getting bigger and bigger, but we never get any figs.
And I'm sick when I look at our Korean maple. It definitely is not happy here. And they say we should not be pruning it in late summer or even in fall.
No, not until next spring.
So I don't know
and
what's
I have
what
a feeling we just didn't water it enough. It doesn't get enough water.
It was a really hot, hot summer.
Yes, and although, you know, I did water it periodically,
not
it wasn't enough.
Yeah.
But they don't like to be soggy either. The tomato berries.
Oh, they've been prolific this year.
They have been, and we've neglected them because we've just been busy with other things. But they still go. I mean, they will go on and on.
Well, they're indeterminate, so.
Yep. And at this time of year, they do split and they do fall off.
But, which is rare, because well, normally...
only until this time of year.
I mean, if you look at these, that's beautiful.
It is beautiful. Oh, good, thanks.
Well, I didn't mean to have you eat it.
Really?
I mean, my goodness.
Here, I'll give you one.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay.
Yeah, I get one. And how many have you eaten so far?
I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I might eat a split one here.
Yeah. That's why they never get in the house.
Why?
You're the example of why they don't get into the house. I have to come out here and fend for myself. And kale this year, I mean, we've neglected that.
Yeah, we're terrible.
We have not...
See that kale? That kale grew from a seed, from a plant that we had
three or four years ago.
Yep. And suddenly the time was right and it decided, well, I think I'll grow this year.
I do like the dinosaur kale though.
I do too.
Now your hostas are blooming again? Still?
This is an interesting. This is a double flower head.
Yeah. Now, we don't know the species of this one, though.
No, we
don't. Was this original to the property?
Nope. Mm-mm.
So we did.
I have a feeling we bought it...
at a plant sale?
At a plant sale, yes. And these are caladiums. Again, these are tender bulbs. So each one of those has to be dug up. And the bulb...
including your elephant here.
Right. Now, it bothers me that these have taken so long...
I mean, look how tiny that is.
Right. I have a feeling that they are not...
they're not happy.
They haven't grown enough so that there's enough of a seed to make it through the winter.
So their bulb hasn't been regenerated.
That's my fear. When I dig them up, we bought these new this year. But we got them late. So, Montauk daisies, here they come.
Yeah.
One of the last ones to blossom.
Now, we found that the ones we have in the container in the back have grown so big in basically 2 years that they're flopping over.
We did not trim them down
enough
in the spring.
I know, yeah.
So it's important when you have Montauk daisies that in the spring you don't let them get taller than this after you trim them.
So about 12 inches at most?
Right, at the most. Yeah. Right. So otherwise... they do form like a, I don't want to say a woody.
Well, they do
bottom,
have kind of a woody
yeah,
stock.
They do
yeah.
get very permanent, and if you don't take care of that, it's going to be more like a bush that flops over.
Well, the nice thing about it is when you trim these in spring, you're going to have a lot of Montauk daisy babies if you simply put them in the ground someplace.
Yes. Yes, you will.
I mean, how many do you want?
Exactly. That's when you give them away. You share them.
So please come on down behind door number one, number two, and number three. We've got Montauk daisies just
come
waiting
spring.
For you.
Yep.
We're not going to send them, but you got to come and visit.
Yep. We mentioned that some hostas are fragrant, and this is one of the ones we had bought a couple years back, obviously quite a few years back, and this is a fragrant one. We liked it so much that yesterday when we were at Miner's looking for a replacement for our little dead tree, we asked about fragrant hostas. And she said, oh yeah, just go down the path a little way, you'll see them. And when we got it home, we saw, oh, it was the exact same kind as this one. Fragrant bouquet, it's called.
We could have dug this one up and divided it.
We could have divided it.
Well, we still could in next spring, right?
Sure. Or even now.
True.
They're fine. Now, when we talk about floppy Montauk daisies, this is what we mean. We did not, I don't know that we took any cuttings from these, did we? Oh, yeah, I think we did.
We did.
There it is. Okay, but we didn't do enough, and here's a tree growing in here. We don't need that in here.
Well, we were going to try to get these cages in there, but there
was
no way they're going in now.
No, and it would ruin them for the season. I mean, they're not going to blossom if they're all crunched up.
No.
So we'll just leave them the way they are. And this is another mammoth mum. And obviously this is an orange one.
Did it get stepped on or something?
No, it kind of flopped over. So next year we know we're going to have to put a ring around it. Yeah. Right. Well, we didn't realize it was going to get that big. That's our new fragrance, baby. Fragrant bouquet.
Uh-oh. We were smelling the blossoms at the garden center yesterday, and really? Oh, they were delightful. So
yes, they were.
If you like a fragrant hosta, then this is definitely the kind to get.
Yep.
And
here's some more cannas.
I mean, it's like a jungle background in here.
And they're still growing.
Yeah.
I mean, this is one of the younger pieces.
Think it'll blossom yet?
Hard to say. Depends on how late the season grows.
I mean, these are 6 foot tall.
And then, of course, the water peaches goes on. And the water lilies are still blossoming.
And they have beautiful coral red.
Mm-hmm.
And the pink one opened up this morning.
Yes.
Absolutely beautiful. And I see there's another one. Going to pop open. I think that's the yellow one.
Next to the frog. The guard frogs.
That is so delightful. I mean, just sitting out here listening to the water. We did a meditation video a couple videos ago, and
yes.
It changed my whole attitude that day.
Yes,
it was delightful.
It was nice.
I needed it.
And you said somebody is pushing some of your geodes.
Yes, I saw this morning. I had actually stepped kind of strangely over this water section and pushed my geodes back because they were almost ready to fall over. So.
Well, you know squirrels jump up here. And
well, they had
like
already knocked this Inca kind
that
of image
into,
over.
Yeah, well, that one's
that
been
in the
pond,
yeah.
Right? Yep.
And I know we have another little frog that resides down here.
There's at least two more.
And you can see some of the goldfish down there too. I know at one point we put three here and three in the upper. And one day when I looked down in the lower pond, there were four.
No, I think we put four in the upper and two in the bottom.
Oh, that's what it was.
Mm-hmm.
That's what
and
it was.
And then
yep.
one of the four up here decided to join and make it three and three.
Yep, because now the teams are even.
This spring when we couldn't help ourselves and went to Farm and Fleet, I believe, and there were bulbs that we thought, that's interesting. We bought one package that had gladiolas, regular yellow gladiolas, and then they also had a little package that said it was a fragrant gladiola. Never heard of that before.
So is that one fragrant?
Yeah, I think it is.
Now it's not like the gladiolas
no.
I'm familiar with. This
no,
is a
it
different
isn't.
Species of
well,
gladiola.
I almost breathed in that bug. Go away. No, and they are on a stem where they're
very tall. At first I thought they were the Asian lilies.
Ah. But there's multiples on each stem.
Yeah.
They took a long, long time. The other gladiolas are over there in that
That's
container.
Where they were. Yep.
And
yep.
They've been done for a long, long
yeah.
time. And suddenly these started to come out, and that was cool. But last year in this container, we had Cleome. There's a little bit of one.
It's still growing on the other side.
There's another one. Came up from seeds. So we just let them go, call them volunteers. But this is a very interesting flower.
Yeah. Like I said, it's so different from the typical gladiolas
yes.
that I see.
And
very
all of them have that one little one leaf that sits up and has no color, and the other inside has a marking.
Kind of reminds me of Batman upside down.
In our short backyard, we have more of these. They're called cut and come zinnias, which encourage you to cut the old ones so that the new ones will come out. And that's exactly what happens. Now, most zinnias do that, but this is what this one is called. These are interesting ones. And it was a variety of seeds when I planted them, so you never know. balloon flowers.
Still going away.
That were probably 4 or 5 feet tall.
Mm-hmm.
And they're blooming this late, I believe, because most of the afternoon they are in shade because of these trees. So it just prolongs the season. This is a mum that we have had for decades. It's not a mammoth mum. There weren't such things when we got them. They're tiny like that.
They're about a nickel size.
If you cut these off, which I do, the new ones the white ones will come back, and you can extend the season. They look kind of ratty right now because some of them are done and some of them are waiting. That's our original pond. We don't have any critters in there, but the frogs do swim around in there. They're happy. This is the original Montauk daisy, where all the other ones have come from. And you can see that in the spring, we cut them back, well, way back.
Yeah, well, like you said, about, not even 12 inches above ground level. And they will re-sprout.
They will re-sprout. And you can see how woody they get. Now, it might be that we'll take that whole clump out of there and just put some new stalks in there that we clip off.
And definitely, we're going to put supportive rings around all of our Montauk daisies now, knowing
it'll help them, right?
I mean, because once they start growing, they grow pretty quickly and get very tall and very heavy.
Yes, they do. This is the red Anjou pear tree that this year gave us so many beautiful pears, and most of them were disease-free and insect-free. And I was able to make some pear jam,
which is
amazing. Mm. I still have a few pears left, and I'm thinking of making another batch.
That was really good jam.
And I didn't use any Shergill. I just cooked it down until it was thick.
Well, you also made freezer peach jam? Jam,
yes.
Right? Yeah.
Yes, I did.
That was really delicious as well.
And this is the European plum. They were little, about this big, purple, very firm. They never did get soft. They're a firm plum. And I treated Rick to one, and I just cut it in half and cut it in quarters, took out the seed, thinking, well, this will be a real nice treat. It felt a little soft on the outside. He took one bite out of it, and it was so sour he couldn't eat it.
Yeah, and you're laughing?
No. But we only
That was
had,
a mean trick you pulled on me.
I didn't know. I didn't taste it. There were only probably 10 plums that came off of this whole tree.
I don't even think that many.
We're definitely cutting this one back in the spring.
Yeah. I got carried away. But again, it's so shaded because of all the other trees on our neighbor's back lot here. But they're still... We're still hoping to get plums.
Yes. And that humongous tree behind me is a Bartlett pear that we planted decades ago. And there are still some really nice looking pears up at the top, but how do you get to them? And once they get to the ground,
Wait a minute. Because whenever we have trees on our property and I can't find you, especially if Logan's over, the two of you are climbing trees.
That was long ago. He's not even interested in climbing trees anymore, but yes, sometimes I dive.
Were you climbing a tree recently?
I climbed this tree last week.
Yes, I know.
There was one apple up there that looked so inviting, and our neighbor, Eva, said, oh, look at that beautiful red apple.
And that was a pink lady, right?
It's a pink lady. Thank you for telling us. And I tried reaching it, and I couldn't. And I said, well, I'll just climb up there and get it. And she said, no, don't you dare climb up there. I said, I've climbed many an apple tree. So I climbed up.
You've climbed many a tree, period. I have to pull you down.
That's not good. Don't do that. Now, we mentioned how it's just so late for these tomatoes to be coming. I mean, look at how many green ones are still ready, still coming. And there's a lot of cracking going on. Even
that
though
could be a song. There's a lot of cracking going on.
It might not be taken good. Well, very
that's
well.
True.
So they're wonderful. This is supposed to be a whopper. It doesn't look very whoppering. We've had bigger ones than that. These golden
were really delicious.
Yes.
Oh my goodness.
Very, very nice.
Is that what we had for supper last night?
Yes, it is. Oh. And that was a whopper.
That was big.
That was a biggie. Yes. But I mean, look at them. They're some of them are huge. It's sad that they didn't.
Well, either that, or you're going to be doing a lot of green fried tomatoes.
We've never had them before, so it might be interesting. Yeah. And again, these were some tomato berries, and
they're
still, you know, some of them are green. Yeah. In the back, you see more green tomatoes back there that are just slow in coming.
Well, I know you pulled out all your zucchini and some of your squash, and now you've got a lot of harvesting to do in your butternut and your spaghetti squash back there.
Yes. And you see that, you know, there was powdery mildew, which is, you know, it doesn't really harm the plant. I mean, it looks ugly, but they're still blossoming.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll have squash in December.
Maybe. And along the north side of the garage are our tree peonies that we planted from seeds. You can see I left a couple of the seed heads on, yes. They just were amazing.
Well, you can see the difference between herbaceous and tree peony.
Correct. And you can see that these will need to be caged as well.
And you see the new shoots that are in there?
Yep. So this is not a time you want to be trimming tree peonies. Those are next year's growth. And if you look closely, there's a lot of them.
Yep.
So come spring, if you need to, that's when you can do a little shaping.
Well, definitely caging.
Take care of any that need disease. If they're diseased or dead, that's when you take them out of it.
Well, that you can do anytime when they're diseased.
You can, but
ideally,
still, it's going to be. We got a bunch over there and a bunch over here.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, ours are all kind of white. Maybe pinkish.
Single blossoms.
Yeah. And behind it, the poor things, we should really move some of these. This is a silver Japanese
painted fern. Yeah, we have to
move
this because I really like this painted fern.
Yes.
It's so pretty.
It's
but now
very
it's totally
pretty,
dominated by this.
Right.
Look at that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's still there.
Oh, look at all the seeds.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you should get those
before they fall. No, we have plenty.
No. I'm just saying, get them before they fall on the ground. I mean, that seed pod opened. Hold your hand open once.
Now,
see?
There they go.
That's what I'm talking about. Amazing.
Yeah. And yet, these can go for years in the ground and not sprout.
These didn't come up for about 4 or 5 years after we originally planted them. And we were shocked when they started coming up. In fact, they're still coming up.
They are.
Even as we speak.
Yes.
I mean, there are new ones growing in that raised bed up there.
Yes.
That's funny.
They're amazing. Well, we're almost back to where we started. And we just wanted to highlight our Rose of Sharon hibiscus.
It's just full of blossoms.
The petals are crinkly, so they almost look like crushed paper.
Mm.
Very, very pretty.
I love those little pink center.
Mm-hmm.
Now on the other side of the same bush, they're just white.
Yes. So I don't know if there are two bushes here that are just intertwined.
There has to be.
And then, of course, across the street is a blue one.
Yeah, that's
that
beautiful.
Our neighbor Josh has. So that's excellent as well.
And his is a double, I believe.
Yes.
Oh, pretty amazing.
If you enjoyed our part two of our September garden tour, please give us a thumbs up. It always helps and we appreciate it very much. Thank you for watching. Also, if you'd like to see more of our garden videos and you haven't gotten tired of watching them yet, down here is wisconsingarden.com. There are many, many there to watch all times of the year. Also, if you haven't also become part of our garden family by subscribing, there is a little orange button over here. And if you just click on that, you will be subscribed to our channel. And above that, up here somewhere, there's a little bell.
Ding dong.
That will notify you when a new video is up and running. So, please be careful, be safe, be happy, be healthy, and be kind. Goodbye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.